Don't you help for a meeting, perhaps work? I hope you are familiar with this passage, the story of Abraham. Now, if you were to read this passage without knowing who Abraham was, who would you say is the hero of faith? Is it Abraham or Abimelech, based on the passage? Who acts like a true believer? And who acts like an unbeliever? Who had integrity and who did not? Who told a lie to save his own skin? Come, let us pray. God the Father, we want to thank you for your word, for we know that your word is the way, the truth, and the life. And as we open your word, we ask that your Holy Spirit be our truth teacher. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable unto you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, I've entitled my first division, Abraham Wandered and Faltered, from verses 1 to 7. So let us take a look at Abraham's journey of faith. The passage begins with, from there, Abraham's journey. Now, where is there? Well, actually, he was in Mamre in Hebron. Okay, let us take a look at the map of Abraham's journey of faith. Okay, can you see it? Okay, if you see Hebron over there, actually he moved towards Negev, which is southwards. But God's instruction was for him to move to Canaan, which is northwards. Okay, so he moved towards the Negev. Right, so that is just to show you the journey of Abraham. So why did Abraham move away from this place of fellowship, away from God and south towards the Negev? Now perhaps he was reminded of the ruins of Sodom and he felt hopeless when he saw it every morning, what God had just destroyed. And he might also be distressed that his relatives did not believe in God. We just learned last week, isn't it? God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. And Lot's wife turned into a pillar of salt because she looked right. Okay, so going to Gerar was not God's plan. We are not told anywhere in scripture that God instructed Abraham to go to Gerar. Okay, it later became a center for the Philistines. It said he sojourned, and that meant he stayed there temporarily and not permanently. In verse 2, we witness this man of great faith becoming the greatest doctor. What happened to the hero of faith? In chapter 18, his righteous and prayerful attitude led him to intercede and plead for Sodom. And in chapter 14, he risked his life to save his nephew Lot. But this time, he risked his wife to save his own skin. And he told a half-lie that Sarah was his sister. Now, why did he do that? I guess there was fear in him. And this caused him to have less faith in God. Now he was thinking to himself, if Abimelech knew that Sarah was his wife and wanted her for himself, he would be killed. Now, if he was the brother of Sarah, his life would be spared. And this is not the first time he has behaved like this. Now if you remember that in chapter 12, he did the same act when he was in Egypt 25 years before. He has forgotten that God made with him a covenant in chapter 12. God has promised him that he will protect Abraham, but he chose to distrust God. Moreover, in chapter 17, God reaffirms his covenant with Abraham. And we also learn from verse 13 that there was some sort of agreement he had with Sarah, that whenever they are in a foreign land, and when the situation is vulnerable, that means when they will when they get into trouble, he will say that Sarah is his sister. So that, so as to get away from any trouble. Yeah? So standing on this side of eternity, we ask the question, why he did not learn from the first lesson? How can a man of God do that? Yeah, he should have trusted God this time, as God has shown his faithfulness in protecting and delivering him from the hands of Pharaoh. But wait a minute, just before we go too far and become too judgmental, we have to ask the following questions. Have we not been there before? Were there no repeated sins in our life? I think as human beings, most of us, I would say most of us, are struggling with some stubborn sin in our lives. And we keep on replaying it all the time. In fact, one of the most common sins is the sin of lying. Sometimes we lie because we fear that we'll lose our friends. Sometimes it could be just to avoid the pain. At times it could be just a white lie to carry favor with our superiors so that we can be in their good books. But when we deal with sin, it can become habitual and eventually it will destroy us. We will lose our credibility and therefore earn a bad name for the Lord. We must not minimize sin, but crucify it and deal with it immediately. Now, compromising with faith has its consequences. It is better to get into trouble and face the music than to get away from God. Now, we may think that we can get away with it for the moment, but in time to come, we will surely face the consequences. It may not come right now, but maybe tomorrow, next year, or many years later. But recall what happened in chapter 12 again, when he lied in Egypt. Pharaoh gave him sheep, cattle, and many valuable items, and even slave girls. At first glance, it seems that lying pays, but it is not so. Later in chapter 13, we see that Abraham's nephew, Lot, wanted to split up with the uncle because of the possessions they had. And through the slave girl Hagar, which Sarah gave to Abraham, this led to the birth of Ishmael, which contributed to the age-old problem. And later we also see the same thing, that in chapter 26 actually, that Isaac did the same thing. If you were to read chapter 26, you can see exactly the same event. Okay? So be careful, as that will be copied and pasted into the lives of our children. Yeah, we say monkeys see, monkeys do. So after Abraham said that Sarah was his sister, Abimelech, the Gerar king, sent for her and wanted her for himself. In many periods of history, it was common for kings to have many concubines. So Abimelech is a title which is likened to that of Pharaoh or Caesar. So it is not his name, it is his title. So the meaning of Abimelech is God is my king. Then we ask the question, why would a king who could have anything he wanted to do with a 90-year-old woman? Even though Genesis 18:11 tells us that Sarah is old, yet Abimelech still wanted her. So there must be something very attractive about her that made him want to go for her, right? So this we really do not know. We really do not know, as the Bible is silent on it. But one possibility could be plainly that she is old, but still attractive. And that was the reason why Abraham planned to lie. So another possibility, as Bible scholars have suggested, was that Sarah was rejuvenated as God was preparing her for the birth of the promised son. Okay? Anyway, these are just speculations and not scriptural truths. Okay? So, but in verse 3, here we see the intervention of God. Okay, God intervened. God spoke to the king and said to him that he is a dead man because she is a man's wife. In verse 4, I asked the question, why did Abimelech say, Lord, will you kill an innocent people? Shouldn't he be saying, Lord, will you kill an innocent man? Okay, remember that everyone knew that it was God that destroyed Sodom. And Abimelech, in this case, he was worried that Gerar will be the next city that God will destroy. Okay, so Abimelech further defended himself, saying that Abraham said that Sarah was his sister, and therefore he did what he did with the integrity of his heart. And God replied that he knew all that he was, God replied that he knew all that, and he was the one who kept Abimelech from touching Sarah. And later we learn in verse 17 that Abimelech was inflicted with a disease, which meant that he could not perform sexually. God then gave Abimelech an ultimatum to return Sarah to Abraham. So here we see the friend of God, the father of faith, sin and told a lie at the expense of his wife. Now, if God did not intervene, what do you think is at stake? The line of promise would be jeopardized, okay? And we would not be here this morning to worship the Lord. And this is the big picture in the whole of the Old Testament. Can you see the promise that God made to Abraham that he will be a blessing to the world, which will usher the coming of the Messiah? This will be disrupted unless God intervened. And in this case, he did. So thanks be to God that he is the author and finisher of his covenant made to Abraham. Okay? And see once again the hands of God charting the course of history. And in verse 7, if your Bibles are open, in verse 7 we also observe that this was the first time the word prophet is used. And yes, we can see that the function of a prophet is to intercede for people, as other prophets have done so, such as Jeremiah and Isaiah. So Abraham was the first prophet, and God has graciously given him this privilege to do so, despite his life. So we also see the overruling grace of God here. When a man of God sins, what happens? God still graciously comes to the rescue and delivers him out of it. But that does not mean that we are encouraged to sin. Don't you also think that it's interesting that God spoke only to the pagan king and not the father of faith? Okay, I will leave that with you to ponder about. Is there anything that we can still learn from the hero of faith who just turned liar? God's heroes were never perfect people in the first place. Okay, Moses had a temper problem and became a fugitive, isn't it? Because he killed an Egyptian soldier. David is another one. He turned murderer because he lusted after Bathsheba, and he also committed adultery. So, but some lessons in scripture are straightforward. It teaches us what we should do. But in this case, the lesson is about what we should not do. And the first principle that I have for the first division is a man of faith is not one that is without faults. A man of faith is not one that is without faults. It's written in your bulletin, in your outline. So from Abraham's journey of faith, he fell at times, and so will our faith journey be. But we can learn from his failures. Now, could Abraham have avoided his sin if he had taken precaution? Now, scripture is written for us to emulate those good examples and to learn not to repeat from the mistakes of others. Now, the first application that I have, you can see it in your bulletin. Seek God always and be in his will. Seek God always and be in his will. How do we apply? Because as we look at the passage, you notice that Abraham's first move towards Gerar is the beginning of trouble, actually. Now, God did not ask him to go to Gerar. Perhaps he was discouraged and despairing after the destruction of Sodom, and he began to take things into his own hands. He puts himself in a vulnerable position where he cannot withstand temptation. And what does it mean to be in his will? Okay, this means that we must be found doing God's will. And what is God's will? God's will can be found all over the pages of scripture. Okay? God's will is that we be saved, we be sanctified, we be suffering, we be the same things, and we be spirit-filled. So use 1 Corinthians 10:31 as a guiding principle. What does 1 Corinthians 10:31 say? So whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. So, is all that we do, is it for the glory of God? If the answer is yes, then we are in His will. Otherwise, you know the answer. The next application that I have is, fear the Lord always. Fear the Lord always. Abraham was caught up with the fear of losing his life, and that motivated him to die. So if he feared God more than losing his life, he would not offend God. He trusted in his circumstances that are always changing, rather than in the God that never changes. His fear caused him to lie to save his own skin at the expense of Sarah, who's having the promised son in her womb. So did you observe that the last two applications have to do with our responsive reading this morning in Proverbs 3:5-7? There it says very clearly, right? Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. All your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. But what did Abraham do here? He did exactly the opposite. Abraham did the opposite of what Proverbs 3:5-7 said. He actually did not trust, seek, and fear the Lord, and hence the consequences. And let me tell you a story. Back in 1998, when I started in my present job, I had a lot of fear in me. I was afraid of losing my job because I just got retrenched. So I began to imagine that everything my boss did was to get rid of me so that he could bring me in, so that he could bring in his own care of people. So I began to be anxious, and when I was told off for something wrong that I did, I took it negatively. Okay? And I thought that my boss was always finding fault with me, and I was being victimized, and I'm being persecuted. So I have that kind of mentality that, oh, I'm the one that is suffering. But this created much unnecessary anxiety and caused me a lot of sleepless nights. Okay, after 3 years of much praying, God opened my eyes to see that no one can touch me. Yeah, if He does not want me to leave the company, or even if the boss wants me to stay because he likes me, he cannot if God does not want it. Okay, I will still be out of the company. So you see here, unnecessary fear is dangerous. Why? Because we do not focus on God, but on our circumstances and lean on our own understanding. Okay, the third application that I have is to remember God's goodness and His promises and cling unto them. Now, Abraham had forgotten the promise God made to him in Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. He says, God will bless those who bless Him and curse those who dishonor Him. And he had also forgotten that God delivered him from Pharaoh when he died in Egypt. Now, we too have been given many promises, isn't it, in the Bible? So such as, for example, just maybe one or two examples. Hebrews 13:5, I think we are very familiar with that. The Lord said, what did the Lord say? I will never leave you nor forsake you. And in 1 Peter 5:7, casting all your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. And a slightly longer one, 1 Corinthians 10:13, I think all of us are familiar with that also. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to men. So when we fall into sin, we can rely on God because He has already promised us that He will provide a way out. Okay, He will not allow us to go beyond what we are able. Okay, and many more. So cling unto His promises and remember His goodness. Okay, so that we can be strong in our faith for the Lord. Okay. Think, these are all written in the bulletin. Okay, my second division, I've titled it Abraham Rebuke from verses 8 to 13. Now in verse 8, after learning that God spoke to Abimelech, the men were all afraid because, as mentioned earlier, Sodom was just destroyed and they feared that they might be next. And then from verse 9 to 13, we hear the conversation between Abraham and Abimelech. In fact, it is a kind of a rebuke. Okay, ironically, we see here a pagan king teaching the man of God integrity. It should have been the reverse, isn't it? In verse 10, Abimelech was asking what information did Abraham have that he resorted to lying. Abraham thought that there must be some knowledge that Abraham, Abimelech thought that there must be some knowledge that Abraham possessed that caused him to lie. And in verse 11, Abraham gave a self-righteous reason that Gerar is a city that does not fear God, and that they will kill him because of his wife. It's not a good idea to imagine that we are the holy ones that are good and holy. Others are little devils, while we are the saints. Okay, in this case, Abraham was the one who does not fear God, isn't it? And that is precisely the reason why he lied, that Sarah was his sister. Okay? He also justified that indeed Sarah was his sister from the same father, but different mother. And that is true, we can verify that in chapter 11, the last portion of chapter 11. That does not nullify the fact that she is his wife. Having a half-truth to cover the whole lie is still a lie. And in verse 13, Abraham used the word wonder. And in the Hebrew context, it means to go astray or to get drunk. Okay? And here, what happens is actually we are brought back to the garden scene of chapter 3 of Genesis, isn't it? Where Adam blamed Eve and Eve blamed the serpent. And this was the first case of a blame shifting. And what Abraham is in fact saying is, God made me go astray. Okay, so he's pushing the blame on God. And sometimes we are guilty of that too, aren't we? When we sin, we need to be responsible to acknowledge that we are the ones who have committed the sin, instead of using God or another person as a scapegoat. And Abraham further justified that Sarah and himself, as I mentioned earlier, made a contract. They have a kind of strategy that whenever they go into a foreign land, they will pretend to be brother and sister. Okay, that was not right in the first place, and he was definitely a clever man when he planned. But what do you think? Should he have stopped it and trusted in God instead? Okay, the second principle that I have does not jeopardize God's redemption plan. Okay, nothing can thwart the plan of God. Okay, man's failures does not jeopardize God's redemption plan. Nothing can thwart the plan of God. You can see that God is the one who is in charge of everything as we read on the story. Now here, what we see is a non-believer rebuking the man of God, which puts him in a very awkward position. How are we going to be salt and light to a non-believing world where we are seen as liars? Who is going to believe in this God that we proclaim about? So we need to be above board to earn the reputation to share the gospel with others. The applications that I have, the first application that I have for this division is do not have a holier than thou art attitude. Abraham claimed that the people in Gerar had no fear of God. Now try not to think that we are better than others. In fact, Paul says in Philippians, right, in everything consider others better than ourselves. So there is what is known as the common grace of God. And even non-believers have the capacity to do good. We do not have a monopoly on God. He is the creator of all mankind. Well, I must confess that sometimes this morning I have a lot of confession to do. I must confess that sometimes I look at people with contempt. Even though you see me smiling on the outside, but I whisper to myself, this person cannot make it. Now, do you know the story of John Newton? Till 6 years ago, I still had this kind of condemning. So till 6 years ago, I still had that pandemic attitude till I heard the story of John Newton, the hymn writer, you know, of Amazing Grace. John Newton was a slave trader. Okay, he killed thousands of slaves, shot many in the head, exported many to be sold across the shores. But one day he became a Christian. He was walking down the streets with his mate, and they saw some people being hung. And his mate said, "I wonder what the disgusting criminal did to deserve that." But John Newton said, "But by the grace of God, there go I. But by the grace of God, there go I." So he understood he had been saved by grace. Now he knew that he should have been in the hangman's place. Most of us understand salvation by grace in the head, but not in the heart. Because grace in our hearts would mean that we would not look down on others. The second application that I have is, do not think that God cannot use non-believers for his end and, purposes. Non-believers for his will and purpose. Now do not think for a moment that they are not good enough for God to use them. Have you experienced this before? And I have. And many times God used non-believing people around me to shape me, a Christian, to show me, to show what I'm doing is wrong and must be corrected. So one example is to be truthful in reporting issues when we were faced with music, especially at the workplace, and I always share this with my IDG group. As we were discussing how to report the matter, my engineer suddenly just blurted up and he said, "Just tell the truth. That is the right thing to do." So myself being the superior, I had to pretend and agree with him. "Oh, yes, yes, yeah, that's the right thing to do, you know." So I had to agree with him to do so. But deep in my heart, this is a rebuke to my conscience. Okay, how can I, a Christian, be told by a non-Christian to be telling the truth? What a shame I am. So, I'm not sure whether you can identify with this or not, but many times God puts people around us to teach us lessons that we have not learned. But the next application that I have is to be a noble sinner, if there's anything such as this, but be a noble sinner, acknowledge our sin, and do not justify. So Abraham erred further by using God as a scapegoat, saying that God made him go astray. So when we sin, we must be courageous to admit our failure and not try to blame God and cause ourselves to be sinning again. So, and yes, sometimes we hear statements like, "Why did you give me a wife like that?" Not me. I didn't say that. Non-believers usually use the phrase when things go wrong and say that it is fated, right? You always hear the word fated. So what they are saying is actually that the problem is with God. It is alright for them to say so. Why? Because they do not know God. But for Christians, we must not. Because we know this God. Okay. Right. And we've come to our last division. I titled it Abraham Respond. Okay, next, from verses 14 to 18. So next we see the generosity of Abraham. We see the generosity of Abimelech in the giving of sheep, oxen, and slaves to Abraham. He allowed Abraham to dwell wherever he wanted. He also returned Sarah to Abraham and gave him 1,000 pieces of silver. Unlike Pharaoh, right? Pharaoh asked Abraham to please get away from the country, you know. We do not want to have any more trouble. We don't want to have anything to do with you. Unlike Abimelech. Okay? He also returned Sarah to Abraham and gave him 1,000 pieces of silver. And this is also to vindicate Sarah. Okay, to vindicate Sarah. Why is this so important? The scripture reports it. Once again, God does not want anyone to doubt on the line of the promise. Okay? You will have people questioning whether Isaac is the son of Abimelech or the son of Abraham. And that will create a lot of confusion. So, and Abraham, here he lost the opportunity to reach out to Abimelech. Instead, Abimelech must have a very bad impression of the God that he believed in. Okay? Even though this God is very powerful. But notice Abimelech's insinuating statement to Sarah at verse 16. Behold, I've given your brother 1,000 pieces of silver. Okay, he still feels wounded about the whole incident. Abraham then interceded for Abimelech, and we will be wondering, what did he pray for? I think he must first confess and acknowledge to God his sin. Okay? We learn from the book of James, other parts of scripture, that the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Okay, one who comes to God and confesses will be made righteous, and God is faithful to forgive as he had promised. Okay? Then he prayed for Abimelech, and he and his household was healed. God was gracious, okay, and granted Abraham his request. And the principle that I have, a long principle, in spite of man being unfaithful, we can see that Abraham was unfaithful, God is still faithful. And we see the overruling grace of God at work in all the characters, and that he is sovereignly in control of every event to keep his covenant in place. And that is very important to us, isn't it? If something were to happen to Sarah, then the line of promise is jeopardized. No Isaac means no Messiah. No Messiah means no Good Friday. No Good Friday means no Christmas. And no Good Friday, no Good Friday, no Easter. No Easter means no salvation. Right? And that is so critical for us believers. And the application that I have is, don't despair. God is faithful and gracious. And here we see God's overruling grace in the life of Abraham, despite his sin. Instead of giving Abraham what he deserved, but God still used him as a prophet to intercede for Abimelech. So as God restored Abraham, he will also restore us when we fall. Okay? If you have sinned big time, don't despair. God has provided his son Jesus, that whoever confesses his sin to him is faithful and just, and he will forgive. And we are very familiar with 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And for those of you who have not come to know the Lord, you too can have that privilege to be pardoned of your sins by having a Savior to bear for you. So, we come to the end of the sermon. And who is the hero of faith here? Abraham or Abimelech? Yes, we saw Abraham fell. But be warned that if the friend of God can fall into sin, how much more then can we? Therefore, there's even a greater need to pray for our pastor, our parents, our teachers, and leaders. For all, none of us are immune to sin. So remember, the big picture that we learn here is that God is a covenant-keeping God. Moses wanted his readers to know that the sins of man cannot thwart God's plan of redemption. Though man cannot be trusted, God is faithful and will fulfill the covenant he made to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 3. He is sovereign and in control of everything. And he will also protect those whom he has chosen for a specific task. Remember too that if you want to be a man of faith, you must always seek God's will, live with integrity, and know that when you fall, you can depend on this faithful God to restore you. Let us pray. Father, Father, we want to thank you for your promise, keeping God. Help us, God, help us to remember to always seek you and to live by faith, knowing that when we fail, we can come to you, for you are faithful God, that will surely restore us as you have promised. And we give thanks and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.